Safety is the most important consideration for water quality monitoring, so we will be reviewing the following safety categories: how to ensure your personal health when sampling, how to collect data safely, and trespassing laws that concern volunteer monitors. First, we'll talk about things to consider to ensure your personal health. It's recommended that you check with your family physician or county health department to discuss appropriate immunizations and learn about any health and safety guidelines. You should always wear some type of foot protection. Never go barefoot or wear sandals in a stream while doing volunteer monitoring. Boots, old tennis shoes, and waders all provide good protection from sharp objects. Wearing a life jacket is important when the depth of the stream is unknown. Better yet, don't enter a stream with an unknown depth. If you have young children with you while monitoring, they should also have a life jacket on. In order to protect yourself from insect bites, having bug repellent on hand is a good idea. In order to protect yourself from disease-causing pathogens that could possibly be in the stream you are monitoring, avoid water contact with your eyes, nose, and mouth. Also, try to avoid letting water get into any breaks in your skin, such as blisters, cuts, and sores. Do not rub your eyes or bring your hands to your mouth until after you have washed them with soap and warm water. Next, we'll discuss how to safely collect data while you are sampling at your stream site. Use common sense, unlike the person in this photo, who's using an expensive 30,000 plus pound machine over the stream bank. Your safety is far more important than any data you might collect, so do not enter the stream when the current is swift and the depth of the water is above your knees. It is hard to maintain your balance, and the force of water can even knock over a strong adult. The buddy system should also be used when possible. If you have to go out alone, make sure to tell someone where you are going to sample and when you plan on returning. You may come across chemical storage drums or tanks while in the field. It's very important that you do not touch, open, move, or relocate a drum until it's verified to not contain hazardous waste. First, look for an identifier label, which lists a manufacturer, contents, and hazards. If a label isn't present, assume it's hazardous. Again, do not move or touch the drum. Next, check to see if the drum is leaking, off-gassing at the seams or lid, or bulging. Lastly, take photographs, note the location and coordinates if possible, and mark the area with a bright flag and do not disturb sign. The reason we say not to remove a drum from the site is because if you do, you now assume all responsibility for the drum and its contents. This includes fees for disposal and environmental risks. This will also interfere with locating and holding those responsible for leaving the drum or tank accountable. You should contact the Environmental Emergency Response Hotline so they can investigate and dispose of the drums. Now would be a perfect time to put this number into your phone. Another danger you could run into in the field is meth waste. A wide variety of items can be used to make meth, and many of them are common household items. Be extremely cautious if you come across any of the following at or near your stream site, because they can be extremely hazardous. If you find any of the above items, do not touch or remove them. The best thing to do is to leave the items alone. If you come across what you believe to be meth waste, identify and document the location, call law enforcement, and take pictures. Meth can be made in the single pot or shake and bake kits, which makes it easy to make meth in more secluded, wooded areas. Pictured here are different kinds of meth waste. On the left is a gas cylinder, which may have a blue-green valve and can be extremely unstable and dangerous. In the middle is a cooler that can hold shake and bake kits or separate ingredients. Other containers like duffel bags can also contain these items. Lastly, pictured on the right are soda bottles being used as shake and bake kits, which are highly reactive and can explode. Now we're going to talk about chemical safety. Safety data sheets, or SDSs, are documents that can be found on the Stream Team website. They are also included with every chemical kit and chemical order you receive. Information about chemical composition, hazards, disposal, and ecological information can be found on the SDS, as well as other information. Make sure to keep the SDSs for your chemicals somewhere you can easily access them for reference. All of your chemicals should be kept out of reach of children and pets. While not completely necessary, it is recommended to wear safety glasses and gloves while handling any water quality monitoring chemicals. Store chemicals in a safe, cool place away from moisture. The chemicals used for water quality monitoring can be disposed of at home. Expired powders and tablets should be thrown away in the trash, and expired liquid should be flushed down the drain with cold water. Liquid waste from the nitrate and dissolved oxygen kits should also be flushed down the drain with cold water. Lastly, we'll cover the laws regarding trespassing and how to avoid unintentional trespassing. Volunteers and program staff do not have a right to trespass just because they are monitoring water quality. You have to ask permission to monitor on both private and public lands too. There are two different kinds of trespassing. The more serious of the two is first-degree trespass, and it occurs when a person knowingly enters and remains unlawfully on private property. The property must be fenced or enclosed in a manner designed to exclude intruders, and notice of trespass is given either by actual communication or if the property is posted. First-degree trespass is a Class B misdemeanor, and the penalty for this can be up to 6 months jail time and/or a fine not to exceed $1,000. The second, less serious kind of trespassing is second-degree trespass, and it occurs when a person trespasses unknowingly on private property. It is an offense of absolute liability, and because of this, the land does not have to be posted or fenced. Second-degree trespass is an infraction, and the penalty for this could be a possible fine, but will not result in any jail time. When in the field, you should heed any signs such as no trespassing, no hunting, posted, or keep out. Trespassing is illegal and dangerous. The purple paint statute specifies how purple paint can be used by landowners to protect their property from trespassers. The law specifies a purple post cap or a vertical line on a tree, but keep a lookout for any purple, including things like bandanas and flags. When you see purple, assume it means keep out. You can monitor on private property, but make sure to ask for permission from the landowner. When getting permission to monitor, visit the landowner and explain your objectives. If they don't want you to monitor on their property, look for a different site. If you choose to monitor in a park or on any state land, ask for permission from the park or area manager. It's good practice to carry your stream team identification card to show landowners so they know what you're telling them is true. Here is an example of the use of purple paint on a tree. The statute states the paint must be a vertical line of at least 8 inches in length, and the bottom of the mark should be no less than 3 feet and no more than 5 feet high. The marks are also supposed to be placed no more than 100 feet apart, and need to be readily visible to any person approaching the property. Even if the painting markings don't meet the legal requirements, they still mean no trespassing. Here is an example of the use of purple paint as post caps, which can also be sprayed onto trees. The statute states that a post cap needs to be marked on at least its two top inches. The bottom of the cap or mark should be between 3 feet and 5 feet 6 inches high. Marked posts should be placed no more than 36 feet apart and must be readily visible to any person approaching the property. Other examples of purple paint found on properties are purple pieces of fabric, bandanas, flags, simple purple signs, and haphazardly sprayed or brushed purple paint. If you see the color purple, treat it as a no trespassing warning. If you're looking to ask permission to monitor in a certain area, you can contact your county assessor and use a plat map to figure out who owns the property and have a discussion with them about monitoring. Some counties have interactive GIS mapping software online, but not all of them. This is the landowner permission form, which is a great tool to explain who you are and why you are asking for permission for access to someone's property. Taking one of these with you if you are having a conversation with a property owner is very beneficial. In conclusion, please make sure to take going across someone's private property seriously, and make sure to be cautious while monitoring. Here is a list of some links that can be used to find additional resources and training videos. If you have any questions, please contact us either by email or phone.